autumn of 1989, people of all faiths gathered at Canterbury, in the town and at the university, for a festival. They wanted to share their concerns for the environment, but they also wanted to share their liturgies, their prayers, and their deepest beliefs. For some Christians, to contemplate such sharing of worship can amount to a betrayal of the essentials of their faith. And that leads us to ask, should Christians be involved in the interfaith movement at all? The Reverend Tony Higton actively opposed the festival's use of Canterbury Cathedral and is reported to have disrupted the service.
Let me just correct one thing. There was no intention to disrupt the service, but there was a concern over the content of interfaith worship. I have no problem about cooperation on political or social issues with people of other faiths, but when it comes to combined worship, then I believe that we're in grave danger of undermining the uniqueness of Christianity and the fundamental truth in Christianity that Jesus himself claimed to be the only way to the Father, the only way to God. And that was our fundamental problem with this service and others like it elsewhere.
One of the organisers of that festival at Canterbury was Martin Palmer. Although he is a Christian, Mr. Palmer takes issue with Tony Higton.
The trouble with Tony is that he never actually listens to what anybody else says. And he is a classic example. I mean, actually, he's a perfect person really to have an interfaith dialogue because he knows precisely what he's after and he doesn't mess around. He doesn't, you know what he's after. He has a very clear vision. He wants a biblical witness to the nation. He wants us all get back to a rather romantic vision of Christianity running Britain, if not the world. Oh, that's fine. At least you know where he's coming from.
So you'd have to see other religions as either misguided in error or positively villainous, would you?
I believe that they are in error, yes, because Jesus himself said he was the truth, and therefore other religions are in error insofar as they reject any of the truth as revealed in Jesus. Proclaiming the truth is always dangerous in some senses. I abominate any persecution or lack of respect for people of other faiths, let alone people of other races. I think that's terrible, and I wouldn't want anything to do with it at all. My concern is to proclaim the truth as it is in Christ, and not to compromise it.
Christians are not alone in making claims to truth, and not alone either in safeguarding their places of worship. However, the interfaith ideal of promoting understanding asks of believers an openness to others. Rabbi Hugo Green believes this can be realized with integrity.
I think that there are sometimes occasions when it is important to step out of your milieu and go as a friend to visit another place of worship. We have had the Archbishop of Canterbury preach in this synagogue on Remembrance Shabbat a couple of years ago, and it was a great occasion for this community. That doesn't mean that you always have to seek the lowest common denominator, but in fact, you are expressing certain cherished values of your own community, and the others are there to take part in it.
To go as a friend to visit a Christian place of worship is not at all the same as going as a Jew, a Hindu, a Buddhist, or a Muslim to worship a God who, for many Christians, may be an alien God. People like Tony Higton regard places dedicated to Christ as sacred to him alone. To permit interfaith worship there becomes a profound disloyalty. Hence, the interfaith movement forces people to ask the question, what responsibilities do I have to my own religion, as well as to those of others?
Canon Patrick Sukdeo leads an organisation called In Contact Ministries. It works primarily in East London's Asian community. As a Christian minister, and as a convert himself from Islam, how does he view the responsibilities of Christians in their relationship to those of other faiths?
As a Christian, I trust I would have a sense of obligation. Obligation inasmuch that the God who has made himself known to me now wants me to share what I have received from him with others. I do believe, as a Christian, my calling is to be compassionate, to try to be understanding and to be sensitive.
But what sort of understanding is that when your aim must be, in the end, to proselytize?
I would believe that my wife is the best woman in the whole world. But that ought not to lead me to go and put every other woman I meet down. Surely, if I say my wife is the finest woman around, that ought to lead me to assist other women, to respect them and to value them. As a Christian, I have a faith in God, not because I'm better than anybody else, but because He has revealed it to me. In turn, I now look on others and I see them as in need of that love, and therefore I want to share it with them. And to share it with them in a respectful, in a sensitive way, and not by going around saying, look how bad you are, look what I'm going to do to you unless you accept what I say.
The next item on the agenda is a request by discernment.
The Council of Churches for Britain and Ireland tries to link all the major Christian churches. Here we might expect to find a lead for Christians as they try to relate to other faiths. The Reverend Dr. Clinton Bennett is the Council's Executive Secretary for Interfaith Relations.
If people put it to me that it's sinful or wrong to relate with people of other faiths, I ask them to look at the Gospels and to see how in the Gospels Christ himself encountered people who were not Jewish. If we want to witness to what we believe is true as Christians, we have to encounter people, we have to speak with people. And we can't expect people to listen to us and to listen to what we have to say and to what we have to share unless we're prepared to listen to them and to respect them as people. It must be, to a certain extent, a two-way process. Even if you believe that you have all the truth and the other person has nothing at all, even if you believe that the other person is destined for eternal damnation unless he becomes a Christian, even so, you're not going to make much of an impression on him or her if you are seen from the start to reject who and what they are.
People are ever increasingly getting frightened by the world they live in. And when you're frightened, you're not able to go outside yourself and listen to other people. You are hot and hungry for certainties. I often say that it reverses the New Testament injunction, that is, perfect love will cast out fear, but perfect fear will also cast out love.
Kenneth Cracknell was once Interfaith Director for the British Council of Churches. Now he's Senior Tutor in Theology here at Wesley House, Cambridge University. We've come to talk to him and to his students about what he's teaching now about the need for interfaith and its aims.
The fact that Christians live in a multi-faith world has always been true. But as this century goes on, we're aware every day that we read the newspaper that we live with people of other faiths. But there are theological questions, because you and I are in the habit of reading the New Testament and pondering such matters as Jesus' word in John 14:6, where he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Is God the God and Father of everybody? What on earth is he doing, literally, what on earth is he doing in allowing these other great religious traditions to persist? I think we have to work at our theology so that we know, as we have never known before, that there is only one God. He's not a tribal God of the West. I have to affirm, in the end of the day, that for me, to say that God is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ is to say he is the Father of everyone. Yes.
What are you actually going to say as Christians in dialogue? I mean, if you say to a Muslim, Jesus is God, then he's likely to turn around and say, no, he isn't. There is but one God. So how do we enter into dialogue and still hold on to the Trinity as a Christian doctrine?
Christians haven't been very good at this in times past, because we have simply believed that the way in which we talk about God is the true way of talking about God. Now, we're not going to get anywhere in this world on that basis. Muslims also have got to come to terms with the fact that they are not sweeping the world, and have got to relate to us and to hear what Christians mean when they say that Jesus is the Son of God.
How are you going to reconcile your tolerance to Christ's injunction to go forth to other nations, to share the gospel with them, to bring them to God through him who is the only way?
Yes, I think he did say that because he wanted all men and women to find life and life abundant. Now, that's why I am in the mission business. I believe that the resurrection transforms the whole of the human situation. If it were not so, then the whole church can go home. But the way of sharing is not by saying, I'm right and you're wrong. It is always by dialogue, listening, accepting, assuring, affirming.
All of you are Methodists, and you're all training to be ministers, which means you take your Christianity very seriously indeed. Can you really promise me that when you meet people of other faiths, you're not tempted to proselytise?
I actually think we've got a lot to learn from other faiths, and it enriches your own faith and own spirituality to listen to other people and their point of view.
What do you take it that your responsibility to Christianity is?
I have a responsibility to be honest and to be a seeker for truth, wherever that seeking for truth may lead me.
Are you saying then that you could imagine yourself abandoning Christianity if you actually found that the truth wasn't there?
I think to engage in any interfaith dialogue, you have to take the risk that you might have to make that step.
One of the things that's interesting about what you're all saying is that you all seem to have a yardstick of truth that's quite independent of your religions, and yet I'd always believed that the whole point about a religion was that it gave you the truth and that was your yardstick.
Isn't there a danger in certainty? Some of the awful things which people have done in God's name for Christianity have been founded on certainty. Now, I agree, certainty is something which is very comfortable, but I don't think religion is always about making you feel comfortable. Sometimes some uncomfortable questioning is good.
It must then grieve you to see religions that reject Christ.
I don't mind so much their rejecting Christ. It is when they do not understand the deep inner love of God that penetrates all things and frees the human being that I am sad.
The problem for anyone trying to see interfaith as a coherent response to pluralism is that it is itself multifaceted. Even within Christianity, there are many different forms. Tony Higton, for example, offers a kind of minimalist interfaith, a preparedness merely to cooperate on social and political issues. Patrick Sukdeo wants more openness, albeit within a sense that Christianity has a unique grasp on truth. And Kenneth Cracknell takes a liberal approach, prepared to allow that there may be an interweaving of beliefs. As far as I can see, the only thing clearly to emerge so far is that within the interfaith movement there is a serious tension between the demands of fidelity to one's tradition and openness to others. Indeed, the various brands of interfaith seem to have been spawned by different answers to the question, just how flexible can we afford to be? And it's precisely that question that we will be addressing in our next programme. At a Hindu temple in London, a service of worship to the living Indian guru and some say God, Sai Baba. The people here all come from different faiths. They don't all accept Sai Baba as a god, but they're quite willing to share a service with those who do. This, then, is the ideal of the interfaith movement, a world of harmony, a world rid of violent dissent. And yet it is notoriously tricky to put such ideals into practice. One group that does put these ideas into practice is the London-based Interfaith Network, an organisation dedicated to overcoming what it describes as a heritage of tragic misunderstandings. Brian Pierce is the network's director.
There are different reasons why people might want to come together from different religious communities to talk with one another. At one level, there are questions which arise in terms of how we structure our society. But then there may be other people who wish to come together to explore one another's religious traditions in the belief that that will help them to deepen their own understanding of perhaps their own tradition as well as those of other people.
People are a bit too sensitive sometimes, and you've got to know the person to know that they're not being serious about it. It's meant, it's
exactly,
humour, you know.
But if you don't know the person, then, then you'll take it.
There have been the development in different parts of the country of a range of local interfaith groups which have come into existence because people have felt the need to form some structure within which they can pursue relationships between people of different faiths living in a particular area.
Helping people to come to terms with their own cultural and religious heritage must be the first step in helping them to acknowledge and accept religious pluralism. This is the aim of the Multifaith Centre here in Birmingham, and we've come to talk to Dr. Mary Hall, the centre's executive director, to find out if that aim can be realised and how.
It is a charity. It has a board of directors that are Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Buddhist, Jew and Christian. And I'm responsible for it and its programmes. And our work is mainly to set up programmes that suit the needs of the groups that come to us. And then I have a team of people whom we have taken from the communities and trained. So we have two Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jews and Christians, and they do all the teaching.
My question has to do with the Hindu attitude to conversion.
Hinduism accepts, just not tolerates, but accepts all other faiths. So the question of conversion does not come in.
If I, as a Roman Catholic, I stay as a Roman Catholic, but want to live some aspect of the Hindu way of life, that's what you're suggesting, is it?
If you are a good Christian, you're already a Hindu. Sure.
It's obvious from what you said that the benefits to individuals are very great,
mm-hmm.
If only because it centres them in their own tradition.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you see as the wider benefits to the whole community from people actually talking one to the other?
Well, it's more than talking. I think it's also helping them to articulate very clearly on other matters than what their religion is or how they live their lives. I think that people can compartmentalize very easy in our society. You know, I'm this or I'm that, and I'm not this and I'm not that. But our world is so multicultural. It is so we impinge on each other in personal relationships and in every other way, that if one has an orientation of one's life and believe that there is a God, to me that God is all-encompassing. It's not a case of whether you're a Christian or a Muslim or a Jew or a Buddhist.
It is very important to have this place because it is the only place where all the people from all the traditions get together and to understand one another. As there are so many traditions in Birmingham, so many religions, everybody wants to find out one way or another about other faiths and to get rid of the misunderstanding among all of us.
I think the tremendous thing about a place like this in Birmingham is that Birmingham is a place where all of the major faiths are represented. I mean, in fact, Judaism is probably the smallest numerically in Birmingham. It's a relatively small community. But you have everything, you know, sort of Sikhs, Hindus, Christians, Jews, Muslims and so on, all able to meet here and talk with each other, find out about each other. And it's just a wonderful opportunity.
All I hope to achieve is that there is more mutual understanding, there is more understanding of what our faith is, and those so-called media titles which are attached to any faith, like terrorist, extremists, or whatever, actually they are explained and things are put in the right context.
You got married in Kenya or in India?
Most faiths can feel some respect for each other because they share a belief in God. Despite differences, this gives common ground for discussion. Buddhists, especially those of the Theravada school, have no belief in God. This sets them apart from others who participate in interfaith activities. Why then do they get involved?
Because it gives us understanding about other religions and how to work with them and what's their belief and what's their faith. And also it is an opportunity for us to tell them about our beliefs and our activities. And therefore this mutual understanding gives us opportunity to work together, live together peacefully and happily. When we meet together in interfaith activities, the most interesting thing that I have come across is meditation.
Vachatam veditabbo vinyuhiti supatipannu bhagavato savaka sangho.
I found everybody is interested in meditation. Recently we had a conference. I conducted Buddhist meditation there. Christians, Muslims and Hindus attended. And there we found we could work together very well.
Whether it's practicing Buddhist meditation at a conference or learning about Hinduism at the multi-faith center, most interfaith activities involve the simple sharing of experiences. But some people want to do something more practical. Martin Palmer runs the Manchester-based group ICORAC, the International Consultancy on Religion, Education and Culture.
What we're doing is bringing groups together to commonly acknowledge that they are concerned about a problem, and then to go back and work individually with each faith. Take the environment. We bring religions together in order to say, yes, we are all concerned about nature. But the fact of the matter is that a Christian understanding of nature and a Buddhist or Hindu understanding of nature are radically different. And whilst there may be some interchange of ideas, what we're primarily interested in is developing a really good Christian program, which may in fact lead to the overturning of some well-cherished beliefs and understandings, such as the centrality of human beings in the whole purpose of creation. And at the same time challenging the Buddhists to get their program together and to realize that a kind of passive conservation, whereby you don't kill creatures that come near a Buddhist temple, has to become an active principle. So we're looking for transformation and change in each of the religions that we work with.
So why is that interfaith and not just groups of people coming together saying we've got to talk about problems?
It's interfaith because what we're actually interested in is precisely the distinctive and diverse traditions that each faith has. I think most interfaith work is actually a farce. I think it's a tragic farce too, because it's essentially dodging all the major and most difficult issues. It's not dealing with difference and diversity, it's dealing with a kind of superficial similarity.
When you say superficial similarity, what do you mean?
I mean lowest common denominator. Isn't it lovely that we all believe in God? Oh, except the Buddhists who don't quite believe in God, but you know, we'll let them come in because they wear nice robes, so they must be religious. It's that kind of lowest common denominator, and the problem with that is that actually it's totally irrelevant. The great faiths have radically divergent understandings of reality, radically divergent goals ultimately, and therefore to assume that simply because we can meet and talk about how nice prayer is a farce. It's rather like Goebbels and the chief rabbi meeting and discovering they both have breakfast. Well, so what? So what? It's not actually dealing with the differences and the places where we rub and the places where historically and culturally we're actually sore and bitter with each other.
For people genuinely to work well together, they must have a common task with goals that they share, and that immediately raises a problem. Christianity is a missionary religion. Its goal was given to it by Christ's order to go and baptize all nations. Mustn't it be true then that any right-thinking Christian who attends meetings with people of other religions is bound to proselytize rather than merely to engage in interfaith dialogue?
I think dialogue is important. All faiths, all men of goodwill must be in a position whereby they can talk together and not fight each other. But I'd want also to say that dialogue does not necessarily preclude change or choice. And so, as a Christian, I do believe in the importance of, witness, that aspect of evangelism as an essential component of dialogue.
Canon Patrick Sukdeo believes in witnessing to the truth of Christianity. But as Professor Keith Ward explains, there is a difference between simple witness and an outright attempt at conversion.
I'm not against proselytization. I'm all for missionaries, in the right place at the right time. And I'm not against that. I think if you've got something good, you want to tell other people what it is. But you must leave them free. And that's a rather tricky thing, but you can do it. You can say, look, these are the good things, I think, in my faith. Can't you see your way to accepting them? Of course, if I was actually being a missionary, I'd put it a bit more fervently than that. But you still have to leave people free to make that decision.
I specifically don't say that people tried to convert me, but I think it was something that I can accept, that everybody likes to see others coming into their own religions. But in our case, we Buddhists do not try to convert other people. It is completely foreign to Buddhism. We don't go around converting people. What we do to teach everybody how to love all.
A demand for universal love is obviously in tune with Christianity. Christ, after all, commanded us to love our neighbor. So if that were all interfaith amounted to, Christians could feel perfectly comfortable with it. But as we've seen, there are many different forms of interfaith, from dialogue to a demand for the revision of religious beliefs. And for some Christians, that is anathema. They see other religions as having it profoundly wrong, so how can they conceivably adjust their beliefs to accommodate those who are in error? In our next programme, we ask, should Christians be involved in the interfaith movement at all?
This is BBC.
Concentrate instead on the individual and the search for truth. At first sight, this seems unproblematic, and yet it can set interfaith practitioners at odds with their own established religions, for these start with the truth as revealed by God, and all the individual has to do is to accept them. It may seem then that people within the interfaith movement have more in common with each other than they do with people in their own religious traditions. What is so startling about this is that the whole point of the interfaith movement was to build bridges across the chasms that divide religions. In fact, they seem to be doing precisely the opposite, forming a splinter group. The question then must be asked, is the interfaith movement in danger of creating a new religion, the religion of interfaith?
Issa Adonai panav elecha v'yaseim lecha shalom. May the Lord lift up his face to us and give us the family of Israel and the family of mankind.
Rabbi Hugo Green is obviously committed to his own religious tradition. He's also committed to talking to people of other faiths. Yet it's a criticism of the interfaith movement that it requires everyone to believe the same things.
there are two ways in which interfaith is caricatured, and both of them are quite cruel. One of them is the business about it's like a supermarket. You know, you go around, you trundle in a supermarket, and you take this religion off the shelf, you look at it, you like it, you don't like it, you bargain about it, you put it back. That's a grotesque kind of thing to do, and some very responsible people have done it. The other is to say, ah, well, you are synchronistics. You kind of want to create a mishmash. Not true. Good interfaith relations mean, first of all, that you have to be pretty firm in your own tradition. I think if you don't have a degree of security in your own tradition, you probably will have difficulty with interfaith dialogue.
And 2 issues ago, we began to...
A few miles away from Rabbi Green's synagogue is the Council of Churches for Britain and Ireland. The Council's Executive Secretary for Relations with Other Faiths is the Reverend Dr. Clinton Bennett.
It would sound invidious if I say that there are some people who are involved in the interfaith movement who are about the business of a lowest common denominator religion, who sit fairly loosely to their own religion, who see interfaith as an opportunity to put into the pot all the good bits from all the religions of the world and create a nice new stew from out of it that becomes a sort of amalgam of the best within Christianity and the best within Islam. Yes, there are people who would take that approach. But most people who are committed to the interfaith movement stand very firmly and very solidly within their own traditions, because part of what they want to do within dialogue and within interfaith is to witness to the truth as they see it.
Dr. Eileen Barker is a sociologist who's dealt extensively with new religious movements. Does she think the creation of a new religion, the religion of interfaith, is likely to happen?
I think it has happened quite often, because another thing that happens when you get groups coming together is that the people who are believing that too much accommodation is happening split off. You get a schism. And this has happened throughout history. They go back to the pristine, pure religion, and you'll find that the ones who are left, who have sort of joined together, they have created a new religion, in a sense, certainly as far as the schismatic group is concerned.
Brothers and sisters, let us now say together our sharing of faith's prayer. Almighty and ever-living God, Lord of the universe and Lord of our lives, we praise you. You have created us to be your people, drawn from all the rich variety of the world's families, and the world's faiths. We confess that we are prisoners.
Some feel that the blending of religious beliefs is something to be welcomed rather than criticised. As things are, that's a minority opinion, but it's held by some influential people. People like the Reverend Dr. Don Cupid, Dean of Emmanuel College, Cambridge.
I think each of us in the future will have to carve out a personal religious path. We will look to the resources of all the world faiths. We may be Buddhist in spirituality, Christian in ethic, environmental in our relations with the surrounding physical world, but we'll all have to carve out our own personal path in life. We'll be like artists, seeking a vocation, seeking our own true voice. So we'll use the great religions as resources, and out of those we'll make our own individual religious lives.
And what happens when you confront people whose own life is in direct contradiction to yours?
We've got to look for dialogue. We've got to make a world in which people can accept and respect otherness. Most of our religions in the past have wanted everybody to be the same, and that's been especially true in Islam and Christianity, where difference has been persecuted. I want a more plural world in which we actually rejoice in the variety of religions and the variety of different religious lives.
What do you think the result for the world will be if we don't embrace other religions?
I fear we will get fundamentalism and violent religious wars. Fundamentalism is a frantic and desperate attempt to hold on to dogmatic certainties in a world in which they're being eroded away all the time. I think we've got to learn to be more light, more plural, and more generous towards human differences. Otherwise, fundamentalism and war is the future that faces us.
The fear of persecution, even war, is a powerful impetus to tolerance. But even tolerance can sometimes be taken too far. As we've explored the interfaith movement through these programmes, I found it unsatisfactory that some people seem to think tolerance means never challenging any belief, accepting anything whatsoever. Kenneth Cracknell from Wesley College, Cambridge, also finds this disturbing.
Religion very often functions in human ways as instruments of imperial aggrandizement or of suppression of classes and so on. I mean, we're not in the business of supporting the places where religion is being used either for the suppression or the maintaining of feudal attitudes towards women, for example, in the world. And religion often does that. All religions often do that. Mm. Not just Islam. There are certain kinds of Christianity that do that.
It's those who are weak in faith who are the ones who have to fight, because they can't.
That you are contradicting yourself.
It's never surprising when people believe different things. We're all too familiar with conflicts and disagreements. What can be surprising, though, is how much fundamentally different faiths have in common.
You've got to know the person to know that they're not being serious about it. It's meant as humour, you know.
This solid core of agreement is obviously a good starting point from which to move forward. But that brings us right back to the question that's cropped up time and again in this series. Just how far can people go to accommodate the beliefs of others? We've been given three different answers, and that's not surprising. People in the interfaith movement don't always manage to sink their own differences. The first answer we can call lowest common denominator religion. We've already heard it disparaged in the earlier part of this programme, and quite rightly. It's a batch of beliefs accepted simply because nothing in it offends anyone. Even people like Martin Palmer and Tony Higton, who regularly disagree, can agree on this.
I think that any worshipping together and praying together is confusing. It undermines the uniqueness of Christ as the only way of salvation, and I think, therefore, it is best avoided.
If you take something like the Canterbury Festival that we did here in the United Kingdom back in September 89, there was no interfaith service there because, you know, what is an interfaith service? I mean, basically, you know, we don't mention Muhammad and we don't mention Jesus and we don't mention Buddha. We just talk about being nice. Well, yeah, fine, okay. Call it a birthday party then.
I very much doubt that either Mr. Higton or Mr. Palmer would disagree with the second way of responding to others, with tolerance and with respect. For that frees people, whatever their race or creed, to live and work alongside each other.
We use in Hebrew the term tikkun olam. It means to repair the world. I don't actually think we can recreate it, build it up from scratch again. But you can repair cracks in it. It doesn't sound like a very difficult thing to do, but I know it's not an easy thing to do either, because in order to forge this kind of harmony, you actually have to be open to other people. You have to see their ragged edges as well. And sometimes you have to modify your own attitude to accommodate one another.
The wish for a tolerant world is not unique to the interfaith movement. Indeed, it's a project that's been dear to the heart of all great moral thinkers. So in the end, it's the third option I find the best, indeed the unique contribution to social harmony and understanding. This is the vision of religions as correctives on each other. Beliefs are changed, modified, in response to insights from other faiths. The aim isn't to expose error, but to generate a deeper understanding of ourselves and our traditions.
I'm a Christian, but I owe an enormous amount to Chinese colleagues who've taught me to think in terms of the model of yin and yang, these two poles or these two forces that are constantly locked in a kind of life and death struggle, but which out of it comes a balancing act. Now, I find that very helpful because it gives me a model of diversity that still nevertheless panders slightly to my Western desire to have a unity. But I think our greatest problem is that we do not know what to do with diversity. And so we have seen diversity as division and have then had to fight about it.
I began this series thinking that really tolerance was more than enough to free people to live together peacefully. And I still think that that's true. But after having spoken to people in the interfaith movement, I find there's a great deal to be said for going beyond tolerance. We've heard from those who opened their minds to the cherished beliefs of other traditions and ended up with a richer understanding of their own. So they don't look at their neighbours and find them frightening because they're different. Indeed, in their different ways of being human, they find them immensely valuable. We began this series asking the question, are people of different faiths all God's children? And we found that that is the fundamental conviction of the interfaith movement. The people we have spoken to, movingly and convincingly, tell us they are.